It's time for Advice Line. Call now at 800-866-8883. That's 800-866-8883. Here's your host, Roy Masters.
Easter Sunday's coming. I should talk about that a little bit. One of our Jewish boys rose from the dead. And that's quite remarkable, I have to admit. But I'm one of the few that appreciate him. I could understand why Jewish people have vote for Obama instead of, the very Christians that saved them from the Holocaust. They did. Because they've been persecuted over the years by people who called themselves Christians in Europe, murdered and everything. They called themselves Christians, but they weren't. And one must be very careful to herald the holy name and not really represent it, because you actually turn people against. In other words, by tucking yourself into the idea and the concept or a church, and not really changing in the truest sense where you are transformed from within, you actually become a hypocrite but not see it. That's equivalent to a hypnotic state where a person does not see the wrong he's committing. See, I will put those hypnotic states up on the web when my book comes out, Hypnotic States of America. I will show you how a person who is mesmerized is actually in a state of sin. Because, people deny what they do wrong, right? How many of you have ever faced a parent as a child who was absolutely dead wrong but made you look out you were crazy? And even called the police on you or an ambulance on you or want to send you to the mental hospital because you were so upset with what your parents were doing with you. But they were wrong and you didn't know how to deal with it, and therefore it looked like you were wrong. You were crazy. You were violent. And so this is an upside down world. Karl Marx understood how to create conflict and make the other person who reacts to the conflict because of the injustice, looked like the bad guy. And the person who caused the conflict looked like the good guy. And so there's a lot of upside down injustice in this country, but that's because it's systemic in our generations. So everywhere in the world, there are forces who understand this and they ply their trade. They are the devil's advocates. And in America, it's called the liberal. In Hitler Germany, it would be called fascist. But they're both fascists. They just got different names. It's just one's a masculine, start off by violence, and one is feminine. Like in America, it sort of controls by seduction. That's why they use women pretty women to sell things, because, do I have to tell you? It's not men that sell things so much. It's women that will sell you something if she's pretty and personable and you like her and she likes you. Therefore, if something is beautiful and you like it, and it likes you, therefore you must be a good person. That's your assumption. So personality wins. You can have that in men too. You like a person because their personality, and this person, they like you. That could be a sociopath. Sociopaths, they're more believable than God. But Jesus wasn't one of these people. He was a real person and really likable and really lovable. And I want to talk about it tonight, maybe in a way you never heard it before. So will my Christian friends join in? My Jewish friends and Muslim? Do I have any Muslim friends? Or you want to cut my head off? Why don't you stand up? If you are a real Muslim and you love God, the real God, and there's more of you than there is of the other scumbags, so why don't you stand up for yourself and say, we don't agree with these people, and say it vociferously. Otherwise, you're in agreement with them. That's exactly right. If your husband's mean to your children and you don't stand up, you're in agreement with your husband. You're actually supporting him. But you don't want to get hurt. You don't want to destroy your relationship. And America is in agreement with everything wrong with the world because that we want to be liked. Well, no wonder we're losing our power and also earning contempt and bringing harm upon ourselves and our children. Let's have a nice chat tonight this evening. My voice is very tired. I've had this for 3 months now, and it's a cold that goes around the family, but I'm a little bit broken down by all the things that have happened to me through my life. And so I deserve a cold once in a while. Okay, thank you very much. And I hope you can bear my throttly voice. But get past it, and maybe I can help save you and help you understand your Jesus. I understand.
The foundation of human understanding teaches an observation exercise, often called meditation, which permits you to become objective toward your problems and allows your heartaches, bad habits, fears, and anxieties to be completely eliminated from your life without effort on your part. Until you have begun to practice this exercise, much of what you see and hear on the following program may be shocking and upsetting to you. But if you will listen calmly and with an open mind, you may discover the key to the peace of mind and joy for which you've been searching all of your life. And now, from the foundation of human understanding, here is Roy Masters.
Call Roy at 800-866-8883 between the hours of 9 p.m. and 11 p.m. West Coast time.
Well, you may not like what I'm about to say, but you could complain, not to the management, but to me. I would like to talk about Jesus tonight. A Jewish boy, you know, one of our boys made it, I keep telling you. And don't forget, he was born Jewish. And he never became a Christian. And he never meant to start a Christian religion. That's why he never left any books. And the books you have are just letters, which is very nice. It's nice to have them. Nice to know, you know, the changes of thought wrought in his disciples in their journey. Tell the story of, it's a beautiful thing, just like you need the history of your nation. Very important to appreciate the past. And if you don't appreciate the past, if it gets distorted, you don't have a future. And this particular past, and the Old Testament as well, that led to the birth of Jesus. I mean, the world was a pretty bad place. Even Jerusalem. You couldn't expect Jesus to be born in Borneo. They'd eat him. Too bright. I mean, bright people disturb dark people. And I don't mean black people. I mean just dark in their spirit. And so a bright-natured person cannot survive in Hitler Germany. A bright person cannot survive in Stalin Russia. A bright person cannot survive in many parts of the Arab world because you've got to conform and you have to be broken. And being broken and conforming and going along and become imprinted with your culture, you are no longer human. There, if you belong to something, you do not Earth. Now we do have churches, but I remember the churches of Jesus. They were just places where people met. And I don't think they had a board of directors and all the formalities. And so I think it was necessary that we have those things over the years. But the people that could have saved you from that, the prophets, they didn't have those formalities, but you killed them. I mean, not you, but them there. Like people like you, them, at those times. And so many of them didn't survive and because they saw things. And they were intuitive. And I forget which prophet it was. I don't read the Bible very often. I haven't read it for years. But I do remember stuff that's important. I remember David was a shepherd's boy and he didn't have any education. He was bloody good with a slingshot, and he kept the wolves at bay with a slingshot. And he was a shepherd. And I think the Lord is my shepherd. Sort of, there's something connected there. But he had a certain courage. But the reason why the prophet, I forget which, was it Isaiah? Tell me who it is. I'll be okay with it. Doesn't matter. And prophets, you know, are not anything to do with cash or money, making a living. It means you can see ahead. And we should all be prophets because we should all be able to see ahead. And if you are a Christian or you are saved, and you could be Jewish and not know you're saved. See, I'm Jewish and I didn't know I was saved a long time ago. Something was following me all along, and one day I woke up and realized, oh, that's who you are in history. Wow, that's nice. But he was there all along, keeping me out of trouble, saving me. You know, I've been an adventurous person, traveled the world, Africa, places like that, on my own when I was 18, 20. And, you know, I have to look out for myself. Lots of dangers in the world. But there was always something that somehow, and even in the last 30 years when I was poisoned in the ocean, I won't tell you how the poison was, and misdiagnosed and almost died several times. I grew a new heart. I had a car crash, but then I had heart failure after that. I grew new heart valves, but 3 years later, you know, I had a bypass, didn't work. But then I grew new capillaries, I got a brand new heart. And so, how did that happen? And then I had a car crash and demolished the front of my car. And the airbag crushed into my tender area. I got some wire in my rib cage to hold my ribs together until they healed. The wire is still there. It's under the alarm doesn't go off at the airport. But after 3 weeks, I got healed from that. And I could tell you lots of stories. The body knows how to fix things. But it needs in order for that to happen, your mind has to be well. And the reason why you cannot get better is because your mind is not well, because the mind is influenced by the world. In other words, you are in a fallen state from which you need to be saved. You can't save yourself, and medicine cannot cure a fake, false lifestyle, upside-down lifestyle. See, there's two lifestyles possible. The path of good, whatever that is. Right, good isn't something you read in a book. Those are stories about people who are brave and good and saved and all the rest of it, and how they become new people, and instead of murderers, they become saints. St. Augustine was rather a naughty boy, and his father was a pagan, his mother was Christian, but he was a real wild womanizer. And, I mean, really, really wild. But then he had an epiphany and he changed, and you got the kind of man that wrote marvelous books. One on the City of God. I read it once in a while. But the point is, what changes people? And what is this change where it becomes 180 degrees other than what you were? You know, a deteriorating scumbag to a saint. And he converted to Christianity, but it was a real conversion. And it wasn't by verses and chapters. He wrote books, and he tried to explain, you know, what it was all about. I've got to watch my timing here. We've got some callers. And we're going to take some callers in a minute. But this evening, I think I need to concentrate wherever I can. I will be interrupted by callers, I hope, because I need to keep this program religious today, because it's Easter Sunday. So let me say that, what does it mean to believe in Jesus? What does it mean that if you believe in him, not about him? A lot of you Christians believe about him, thinking you're believing in him. You got to be very careful. You are living in hypnotic states. If you belong to a religion, if you belong to a group, and you take their doctrine, then you are being mesmerized and you are being altered by the words of other people, the authority of people. And Jesus said explicitly, do not have a teacher about this religion. And don't call any man father, like they do in Catholicism. Yes, father, no father. I call my father dad. I mean, he's my dad. My father is dead. That's a higher order of things. So when my dad dies, the spirit of him, because I loved him, so the emptiness of his absence converted me, without me realizing it. It transferred the love, the longing I had for him, you know, the desire to eat, the love for him, whatever that is, went away, and there was this empty space. But then it went somewhere, and something said to me, that's not your dad, I am. It didn't say quite like that. And I was relieved. And that was, you know, your Jesus, mine too. So I didn't know that that was the moment. I was only 14. So I developed and what Jesus said he would send. I sent you the Holy Spirit and he will explain all these things to you. But it seemed to me I had all the things that you read about in the Bible naturally. Maybe because it's the lineage of Judaism, which my brethren seem to miss. They got lots of verses and chapters and good stuff. And they're very special people. And they don't have to be perfect because there was a covenant between Abraham and the Jewish people. And even if they're murderers and killers, it doesn't matter what they are. They're still Jewish, and that is a lineage, and that is important. That they're not really that way, but I'm just exaggerating to make a point. They're not that way. But they are perceived that way, opposite. There's the Hegelian dialectic. Here, there is the Karl Marx. They accuse others of what you are. And there's the haters of those who are good. See Israel surrounded by hordes, billions. It's going to be billions. A little tiny group of people. Billions of heathen. That's all they were. Heathen. Heathen are nice people. These are brainwashed people. These Muslims are brainwashed. I mean super, super, super brainwashed. They think killing people is doing God a favor. What kind of people, what kind of person, a real person, thinks that cutting off heads of little children and murdering everybody just because they didn't believe they were in their prophet? What kind of God is this? That you murder and kill and think, it's only because the mind is upside down. This is brainwashed. Yeah, you're listening to me. You're brainwashed. And now those of you who are silent about this, remember, it's only the minority of you that are bestial, vicious, animals, mindless animals. What have you got? No life? You've been reading the Quran most of your life. And what else can you do? You have a meaningless existence. You weren't taught anything. And so the only thing you do is kill for it. That's it. You're like an animal. Can't create anything. And you have intellectuals who know how to manipulate you. And they won't put a belt around themselves. They put it around you. So now, having said that, we got different kinds of gods here. And that's called brainwashing. And so, but brainwashing isn't limited to Muslims. And it's them who's silent about that other group, which makes them complicit. A Muslim who's complicit, doesn't speak up, is one in agreement. And so therefore, I speak up. So I'm not in agreement, and you do the hell what you want, but you're a gutless lot. And I say, coward. Can't look me in the eye one-to-one. You can't do it. You can't do it one-to-one, face-to-face. Can't do it. I'm saying this to disturb you. I really want to disturb you in a good way. Now, I want to talk to just a little bit. I'm going to talk to Jim in California in just a minute. You can hold on. If you put somebody on a pedestal, the commandments, you know, Jesus said there was only two commandments you really needed. Love God, it means to cleave to him. What does that mean, to cleave? It's to be bonded. To be bonded is to be like joined, like Siamese twins, inseparable. But point is, up to that point, because you come into the world, and before you can't help it, your family is broken, and some families are really broken, and more families than not are broken, and the political forces we have that have been silently rising, the phantom forces, the shadow, what is now our government was a shadow government, encouraging us to be perverted and drunk and alcoholic and to embrace sexuality, at least agree with it, and give them rights when they shouldn't have any rights. They should really practice in secret and enjoy their piggishness. And safe-sex marriages, you bought that too like a bunch of idiots, because you don't know how to deal with the hammering of the media. You don't know how to deal with pressure, and some of you will give in, and those who give in become part of a group that says, we've got to give these people freedom. It's sympathy for the beast of homosexuality. Yeah, that's right, the beast of same-sex marriage. It's not a right. It's a wrong. You make a wrong right, then the right people lose their rights. Because once wrong people get in power, they become intractable. You can't move them. You've given power to something rotten, and you've become part of it because you gave it power, because you gave in. But we're talking about spiritual forces here. We're not talking just about politics. We're talking about spiritual forces, meaning you're bonded. You have sex with a woman that's not your wife. Bonding. And you can never have a normal, well, it's rare. But once you taste the flesh like that, it becomes lust. The first time doesn't feel that good. You think, wow, it's not what it's cracked up to be. But you have a hunger for it. But it's pain. The pain, all of a sudden you become obsessed by it. Same with food. You get upset, you start to eat to take the pay of the pain. But the minute you start to get involved with the pleasure of the food, to get away from the pain, what is the pain? Conscience. Well, the minute you, something has entered you through that stress and got inside you, and it hungers for something, drugs, food, alcohol, doesn't matter what it is. It's all bunched together called sin, so that you go to it to escape. Escape from what? Your conscience. That's what could save you. Jesus represents your conscience. That's why they hated him. The lower you sink, the more pain you feel in the presence of that person, to the point where they want to kill you. Fascists, communists, Muslims, what's the difference? Just a person who just likes to kill because destroy their own children. They destroy their own, kill their own children because they're more innocent than they are. They remind them what they're trying to forget, the pain of conscience. The pain of conscience shouldn't hurt you. It's not your conscience that's hurting you. It's the ugly thing inside you that's made a home in you, and you think it's you. And it thinks through you, and you think it's you thinking. It wants through you, and you think it's you wanting. There's no you. There's just it more. And it will lead you back to the scene of the crime, whereby you can, well, if you mysteriously, find a way to say no to it. But until you find what salvation is, you cannot say no to it. It's almost like life, but it's an upside-down life. Life that leads to death. The longing itself is in the wrong direction. It's outward. Set a goal and move towards it. You're moving away from the truth. So when you get there and you have it, you think, wow, I've got my house and pretty wife and lots of money, all of a sudden it isn't enough. So you think I set another goal? The same thing. It's the moving away. It's not the eating of the food. It's the movement away, looking forward to the next bite. That is the trip. And it's always the same way. It's a longing. And the longing is the only love you have. So you have a longing for the world, and the spirit in it rises to the occasion of your stupid little needs. And stupid you remain. It's a hypnotic state, and sin is a hypnotic state, and you're bonded. You're bonded to those things, and you cannot get free, and there is no treatment for it, nor the sicknesses and the diseases and the wars, and the people you fight to the death for. The Nazis fought to death for a scumbag called Hitler. And same with Stalin and there's other fellows. You know, you're going to get your head cut off if you mention his name these days. And so we're living in America, and we're all afraid to speak up. I can see why Jewish people, for example, support Obama, because they feel safe with him. They think he's going to become the king of the world. So they're comfortable, and they're not the same Jewish people as the ones in Israel, who are real people. They have to fight wars and rockets all the time. So they have to have a different attitude. They have a home, they have a country. These kinds of people are not Jewish. Because they support that which they think is, when he's finished being president, he's going to be king of the world. It means the Arab is going to love him. Oh, he brought America down, brought us down to nothing. And he did it single-handedly. Wow. He's going to be the Antichrist. As far as the Muslims are concerned, see, you know, what you've got here now, if you practice a Christian religion, this would never have happened. But you don't own it. But most of you don't know what it is. You think you're a Christian because you go to a church. Well, bullcucky, that's not a Christian. I'm a Christian, and I've got a problem. This is what it sounds like on my program. And are you shacking up with that lady? Well, I don't know shacking up. We just live together. What? Don't you see the contradiction? No, the person doesn't see a contradiction because he's hypnotized into thinking he's a Christian, and he's accepted by the congregation, and that is support for it, support for the hypnotic state. And therefore, he's shacking up, and therefore, he can't see it. See, now, if you watch me hypnotize people and take a person from the audience, and within minutes, you know, he's changing his shoes and standing on his head, I make him do anything I want. And when I ask him, you know, why did you do that? He's got every excuse except that, I made him do it. I said, well, I made you do it. I said, now why did you change your shoes? Oh, they felt uncomfortable. Well, didn't I tell you before you came up here that's what I was going to make you do? Yeah. You remember that? Yeah. Well, then why did you change your shoes? Well, you know, those people got their shoes on wrong. I thought I'd just put them on differently. They feel better. Well, why do those people in the audience wear their shoes on back when they're stubborn? There's your argument. That's what you got here. That's what you got in America. That's your government. It's upside down. And very, very dangerously upside down. And they're like wicked parents who screw that. They confuse and confound and drive their kids to the mental hospitals. The mental hospital is full of kids who have got parents like fascists, Nazis. But you won't call them fascists and Nazis. It's a hypnotic state. It's sin. Now, I've been a half an hour at this. Hang on there. So now, the question is, what is salvation from this? It's salvation is an exchange of bondage. You're in bondage to the world, cannot say no to it. And you're shaped by it, and it lives through you. Salvation is a presence of God that comes into you and bonds you to him, and in such a way, it's bondage, but it's a freedom from wrong to do right. And now you have no more choices, because you belong to him to do his will on earth. Now, how many people didn't like what I said? I'm preaching Christianity. I'm explaining it from its roots. I can go deeper and deeper. I go for hours and days and weeks. There's so much to say about it, but you wouldn't get it. Too stupid. When I say stupid, stupefied. You have no idea to the degree that you are mesmerized or sinful. And sin and being hypnotized are two exactly the same thing. They are different names for the same thing. So when you understand the hypnotic state, and when you see how quickly I'm very, very good at it, I can pull a person off the street and make him act like he's Napoleon. I stop him on the street. Or I could spot certain kinds of people who are very suggestible, and most people are. You've seen the street magicians. It's not contrived. It is actually that they do that. And they could do that to whole nations. You become a politician, you become a dictator. And you're being programmed on so many different levels. In school, you get programmed. You sit all day in some impatient bore. And I don't have to tell you more than that. Now, I can tell you, show you, what Jesus tried to express. It didn't come down very well, the generations. It really didn't. We had 400 years of Inquisition. That tells you something about Christianity. You got burned at the stake if you didn't become one of them. What difference is that between that and being a Muslim? Yeah, burn you at the stake instead of cutting your head off. That's called Christianity. It's a wonder anybody still belongs to it. If I was a Muslim, I'd run like hell and I'd rebel against it. In America, you can rebel against being a Muslim or a Christian or anything you want, can't you? So why do you hang on to it? Because you don't know how to break it, because your relatives and you don't know how to break the spell. If you rebel, you just become, you can't be saved by rebellion because you need to find comfort in some, when you're rebelling. Rebellion means you need support for that rebellion. And something will rise to your being disenfranchised. And that will rise and become your friend. You become a gang member, something like that, see. But then you're still under the spell of, if you want to be have a family, then it's a gang family, then you have to murder for it. So you always have to find something that supports you in your rebellion. And that's either way. Whether you're religious, you're a hypocrite, and whether you're hypnotized. And so you really drive other people to, you know, to the opposite, and the opposites are the same. Go around the earth, you know, the bad guys go around the earth, the good guys go around the earth, and you meet the same devil. No, I don't mean to be rude, but I take Christianity very seriously. And this belonging thing, you go to church, fine, but belong to it and think you're a Christian or a Jew? No way. And Jesus wanted people to experience what Adam lost. That's it. It had to be a natural, so that you didn't need the Bible, you didn't need the scriptures anymore. You didn't need them, but you can read them and enjoy them. But you're motivated by Him who made the universe and you to appreciate Him.
With Roy Masters. You can reach Roy at 1-800-866-8883. That's 1-800-866-8883.
Well, now, where are you, friends of mine? I'm your friend. I'm a friend of your Jesus, and therefore, I'm becoming perfect. Be therefore perfect, as your Father in heaven is perfect. He says become. It is becoming. And becoming is a verb. Is it an adverb or a verb? Help me with my grammar. I never did get far in school. But it's a becoming is a doing thing. And so you can't be perfect because you're not God or perfect, whatever that is. Who knows? Well, that's too much of a mystery. But we're in the image of him, and if we listen to our hearts, the wordless word in our heart, rather than the spoken word that is spoken into our ears, into our brain, called brainwashing. So you become a Christian, a Jew, a Muslim, a Buddhist. But none of you find God that way. It may be a journey that way, but if you're stuck in that role, you're stuck and you can't grow. And then you've got, of course, different forms of political forms of anti-religion, rebels, secular kinds of people, and so the politics, basically. And they're just as self-righteous. The people in the White House, those people surrounding Obama, they are basically murderers. They're potential murderers. They will murder you one day. When they get enough power, they will. It's going to happen, just a matter of time. You can see it coming. And then because they embrace the, you know, Mao and people like that, I forget the name now. They're ridiculous. But Marx, Karl Marx. I mean, they embrace those people. And you know what they did, killed 60 million people of their own. The government, as a government, they killed their own people who didn't agree with them. And though these people are in your White House, see, and they're pulling the strings and bringing you down, but you're too mesmerized. If you're one of them, you don't see anything wrong with it. And if you're a Christian or a good person who have halfway good, you still have a conscience, but you don't know how to live from it yet. You don't know what to do with it. You could just complain about it and hold up signs. But you still don't know how to fight it. You don't know how to deal with your husband, your wife, or your children. So you still have a broken home. I don't care how. If you have a perfect home, there's something wrong with it. Because my home isn't perfect. I'm always at war, in a manner of speaking. There's always something to say, no, you can't do that. There's always somebody doing something to them, playing with me, and I say, no, you can't do that. I tolerate it sometimes. Because it suits me. Or it's not time yet. See, so I know how to not react and wait for the moment. And while I'm waiting, they might get better. They might see me watching them. And just watching them makes them better. Don't like to have that, me watching them. It sort of wakes them to their conscience. When you're listening to me, you feel me watching you. You think, I'm reading your mail. When I start talking to people with their problems, you think, when you call this program, you tell me you got a problem. Before you finished even the question, I already know what your life is all about. Just like Jesus at the well with the lady who had six husbands. He could read her. I read you too. I read my callers. I can read the future 25 years ahead. That's why I'm here up in here in Oregon and not having a nice house on the water in Ventura. I left it there. I saw what was coming. I built a school and lived in a small town because all hell was going to break loose. I knew you'd end up electing a dictator, but you wouldn't. You can't face that you did. You can't face it. You see, you can't believe you did wrong. You can't believe something acted through you. You can't believe how the advertising got to you. But some of you who see it still don't know how to stand up to it. You're even afraid to talk to your neighbor because you're afraid it may be one of those people, and he's nice, but you don't want to make an enemy. No, I don't mind making enemies. We talk over the fence. We talk about politics and religion, but that's not out of bounds for me. If my neighbor doesn't want to talk to me, that's fine. But if I find that my neighbor's like, is a friend, then we become friends. The enemy is the enemy. If he wants to be an enemy, let him be an enemy. I'm not gonna go running around preaching like I'm doing on my radio program. I'm doing a radio program, therefore it's my job to sit on this bully pulpit and preach. But let me talk to you and I know my callers are waiting, but I've got to say this. Now, it says in the one of the Bible, there's two things in the Bible that it says that's very interesting. Jesus was asked about the commandments, and he says, well, really, you can boil it down to two. Cleave to God. Love is to cleave. That's bonding. But right now, you cleave to the world. You're attached to things. That's bondage. And you cannot break it. Because once you fall to it, something rises up from it. From your whiskey, from your experiences, there's something rises up as you get into it. Something gets into you, and it shapes you in contradistinction to what you should have been, bright-natured person. You become a nothing, and you have conflict. And you try to cover it up, or you, in your secret moments, you take it out on your kids and turn them into one of them, clone them. And if you're a boss, you may want to take the souls of your workers, because the money isn't enough. You just bully them into submission and make them work their head off. I get it. But the point is, it's hypnotic. Sin is hypnotic. It's a trance-like state where you walk around half asleep, half awake. Altered state. Altered by what? Temptation. Temptation, pressure, cruelty, injustice. That's why it works. Injustice is hypnotic. Justice tempts you to hate them. Jesus, they tempted him, and he wouldn't hate back. And they tried their best to humiliate him and torture him to death. And he didn't have hate back. That's the key. And now, it doesn't mean to say that you can't fight. I mean, as America, you had to fight the Nazis. You couldn't let the Nazis kill millions and millions of people. Go on like that. Just be you, be next. But if there's enough people in the world that become Christians or understand Christianity and not be a Christian, you can still be Jewish, and you can still be a Muslim if you want to, and you can do your silly little things. You know, you keep your rituals, and that's okay. You wouldn't need to keep the rituals, actually, because I don't. But I still respect them. I am mindful of them, and I know the history. It's okay, I got it all. I don't have to keep doing the rituals over and over again to keep my programming up. My programming as a Jew, a programming as a Christian, program as a modern. I don't have to do that. I know that's a reinforcement of programming. And that makes you less human. You bow down five times a day, your programming is being reinforced, don't you? No, you're too dumb to understand that. I get it. But the thing is, what about you who are not dumb? I would like to talk to Christians, because I think 88% of Americans are Christians, but they're not Christian enough for me, and I'm Jewish. You're not Christian enough. I'm more Christian than you are, in a sense. I see, I do. I fight, but I fight not with force or anger. I fight with passion, but not with the passion of the Christ, not the passion of an angry person. Two different things. Now, here's the thing you need to understand about becoming perfect. It's a process of being tested every day and not being wanting. Those who endure to the end are saved. So first of all, the first salvation is the ability, sudden, the lifting of burdens, the acceptance of the fact that that God has sent his only son, and you believe the message, because he's believable. How could you believe a message without a believable person telling you? But then the apostle was also believable. Everybody who is a Christian doesn't round around knocking on doors and saying, handing pamphlets out. They live that life, and there's something that glows about them, and you can't help but believe them. And when they talk to you about what I'm talking to you about, then you can really believe them if they talk to you about Christianity, even though you think you're a Christian. Wow, there's more to it. There's a real salvation, a real disenchantment with what enchanted you. That suddenly all the things you enjoy, you don't. All the earthly things you enjoy, and you're detached from them, and you're not attracted so much anymore. It goes away. Material things are not important, although you can still have them. So, but you're in bond. You have a bondage to him, and that you don't want to be free from that. You want to be in that army of light. You don't want to be choosing. So I find myself not choosing anything. I don't have to make choices. I don't have to make decisions. The decision is obvious. The light is always on the lamp of my feet. Therefore, I don't have to make a decision because how else would you do it? But if you're lost in your intellect, you don't have that light. And therefore, you worry and you weigh one thing against another. Now, so that is a path. And so that's what it means by doing the will of God in a continuous, unbroken chain. Now the next thing, rising. If you believe in him, into him, he's into you. Simple. Now, that I hope that I can help you with that, and that I'm giving you a foundation that even Christianity can be a hypnotic state, and no match for what is coming down to you now. You are no match being that kind of Christian who goes to church and sings a few songs and on with Christian soldiers, and that's it. And so you still drink, and you still got problems. You got post-traumatic stress disorder. You got your kids that you run off, and they don't want your Christianity. They don't want anything to do with you. And they shack up, and they drink, and they drug, and you what? And you can't control them. No, because you don't have the authority. Authority is not just because you're a parent, and therefore you got to do as I tell you because I'm your parent. That's not it. There's more to it than that. You have to be a representative of what you want your child to be. You bear witness to that in the child, and the child will love you. But you don't know how to do that. How many of you are impatient? You're killers. You're impatient with your children, you are killing their souls. And eventually, when they try to speak up to you, how dare you speak up to me? I'm your mother. I'm your father. But they need to speak up to you. Say, mother, father, we allow that. It's important to allow your children to speak up to you. Otherwise, they speak up to you contemptuously or secret contempt to you. And you lose them. I want you to be Christians in the truest sense. And I will take that if I have to take a little bit more time after this break. I'm going to tell you what it means to be rise from the dead with him. Okay? I'm Roy Masters. FHU.com. Support my program. Now, I tell you, I'm more Christian than you are. In a sense, I'm still Jewish. You go figure. Oh, here I am again. There's one caller. I'm going to take my calls after the break at least. If they'll just hang on. They're very good questions. One says, wondering why I'm so hard on people. Not hard on you. I'm just telling you the truth. If you were... we won't go into that right now. Because I have to have to talk to the person. Then it's Jim. Was Jesus an earthly father without sin? Yeah. All right, we'll do that. We'll talk about these. Are good questions. But let me finish... because I'll never get around to it if I wait for a person to ask the question. And then never. I have to raise the question, and I have to answer it. And say, what does it mean to rise with him from the grave? Because that's what you do. Now, we'll talk about it. Let me talk about that, because it'll only take me a few minutes, and I'm finished. Then I'll take the second hour with callers, 800-866-8883, Monday through Friday, 9 to 11. Are you enjoying this? I'm enjoying talking about it. And did this bother you? Does this bother you? Why don't you have the guts to say you're out of order? If you don't like what I'm saying, pick up the phone. Because I would do that on television when I hear the other stations other than Fox. I like to do it with Fox too. They say these disgusting things about the Tea Party and all the rest of it and good people. I like to take them to town, but you can't do it. You can't pick up the phone. You can't do it, so you have to put up with it. I just turn them off. I hope you don't turn me off, because I'm on your side. I want you Americans to be Christians. 88% of you, you be a Christian, but you be strong in it. And you don't kowtow to nobody. And you don't listen to those people who intimidate you and, and make you look like you're the bad guy because you, well, you're not bad guys, you're just not strong enough to be good ones. See, that's the difference. And so, you don't mess with me. I don't care how big you are, you don't mess with me. I really don't. It's been tried, but you're not dealing with me. See, that's the difference. They weren't dealing with David when he slung that stone at Goliath, right? Goliath wasn't dealing with just a little boy. So that's what I want to be in you. Okay. Support my program. Okay.
Line with Roy Masters. You can reach Roy at 1-800-866-8883. That's 1-800-866-8883.
But now look, if you put somebody on a pedestal, you must never put anybody. You mustn't put your wife on a pedestal. Because the minute you start putting people on a pedestal, you make them God. And you're the God maker, greater than God. Or to put it in domestic terms, if you make your husband the boss, you're the boss maker greater than the boss. He just thinks he's the boss, but you are. So if you put somebody in a pedestal, you're actually giving them the illusion that they're something they're not, but that's an illusion that depends upon you liking them and them doing what you want them to do. See? Get it? So... but then your whole life, damned if you get it and damned if you don't, but your whole life revolves around your husband, your wife, or whoever it is. And they can do what they want to, and they can run away and leave you alone, and you cry for them, even though if you get them back, you know they're going to destroy you. You're bonded to them. That's bondage. And if they die, and you have a good life with them, and they give up their life, they die from ulcers, they'll die from something if you have a good life with those people, they just give in, give in, give in, and pretty soon you are King Kong with bloomers or whatever. And so then your husband dies, and then you hate God for dying, because now you have nothing to live from. You're a parasite. And so you every now and then you go into your imagination and you call up their ectoplasm from the grave, and curse them again, or love them again. In your as you're dying, see? And really, you're in the grave with them. That's what you are. Now, what a different thing with Jesus. Nobody ever rises from the grave, but there was something about him that did, right? Goes through his trials, he becomes purified through them. He values the spirit more than the flesh. He says, don't be afraid of those who kill the body. See? It's the spirit they want. Got it? That's why you got to be careful about being upset and resentful, judging. But that's another story. You know, I talk about that. This is my Easter Sunday talk to you, hoping that you appreciate my Sunday. Watch my Sunday talk on the website fhu.com. I'll be talking about this, and I'll have questions from the audience. You might want to come up for the weekend to Oregon. Okay, if you're not too far away. And you have a lunch, no charge. And you can stay the night. It's very inexpensive, $150 for bed and breakfast. And you can stay at the ranch. Nice place, all remodeled. Now, so if you have bonded with him because of faith, therefore the faith is the secret. Adam doubted God because he believed the woman who believed the serpent. I didn't die, see? She didn't know what she was saying. She just was innocent about that. She didn't know. It was up to him to say, put it down, you did wrong. But he looked at it and then doubted the wordless word. And the spoken word became the strongest force. As it is, that's what makes you suggestible. But you have to learn a way to stop making that word stronger than your conscience, because it will always make you doubt. That's why the Hegelian dialect, that's why the arguments arguments, verbal arguments that make you lose because there's this shout louder or they're more seductive. They can twist and play with words, and if you're not in your center, if you're not God-centered, they can play with you and pull you in, and once you're in, you can't get out. And if you hate them, you use an anger of energy to get out, but you get more deeply entrenched. So, to get to the point. So, when you're bonded to your Creator, you're a new creature. And so you'll be beget with trials and tribulations. And every time you meet a circumstance, and you are not intimidated by it, but you can't lose. In other words, the enemy is a parasite. He has to take your life force. He has to degrade you to function. After a while, they get upset because they can't upset you. They can't get you, and it makes them angrier. But you get calmer. You get stronger in your calmness, in your inner strength. And the enemy cannot advance. This country would be saved if the adversary, if you could stop being upset with people, you wouldn't drink, you wouldn't smoke, you wouldn't get drunk, because you'd be a whole person. The joy would be in the adventure of being intimidated and tormented. It's an adventure to people making you fail, and you walk through it. You walk through the fire. And even if they take everything you've got, you come out the other side a better person, and things get better for you. You are magnetic. Things fall into place for you, effortlessly. So therefore, if you believe in him who can save you, then you have his nature in you. And so since he was executed and died for our sins, and he rises on the as he conquers death, what form does he rise? The body's gone. What you do not know, or whatever it was, he rises from the grave. But even such as he rises, so do you, because you are in him. As you are in the person you put on the pedestal, and you gave them ulcers and they died. See, or you attach yourself to them and can't stop grieving. There's a fat lot of good it will do you. All right. Get a copy of this program. It's poor. Nobody's mentioned it, so 6518. 6518. You want to get a copy of this program, you find it. Enjoy it. Listen again. Oh, copies of this program is the second hour. I don't know how good it would be, but it'd be callers, and they've been waiting for a long time, and I'll give them the courtesy of, I'll take it the first 5 minutes, and after the first 5 minutes, I will take up the callers, okay? 800-866-8883. Anybody have any problem with what I've said? Dare to step forward, please. I won't talk you out of it, just you try to talk me and show me where I'm wrong. You'd be really stupid, wouldn't you, to show me where I'm wrong? What have you got to offer me in place? Nothing. Right? That's it. You haven't got anything to offer. What have you got to offer? I just told you what I thought of everything else. It's all the same. The whole world's mad. And everybody's a little bit crazy. Some more than others. It's the craziest ones that win. The craziest ones. The most mean, manipulative, soulless, vicious, sly, cunning. They get into you. That's how you got this government. Can you imagine Americans electing a communist government and not willing to see it? So you're typically mesmerized, and even if you can see it, what can you do about it? Nothing. I could show you, but you won't listen. I'm one of those people like the prophets. You tuck yourself deeper into your pleasures and your self-righteousness. And you'll go where you need to go. Okay. FHU.com. Go to my website and get the CD. He's still alive.